Research into the medical uses of psychedelics is at a beginning stage now that could actually blossom into a kind of renaissance. Just recently, San Jose saw the largest gathering of psychedelic researchers ever. The conference was called Psychedelic Science and the 21st Century, and it was sponsored by M.A.P.S, Multidisciplinary Association for Psychedelic Studies. And today, our guest is Randy Hencken, and Randy is the Communications Director for M.A.P.S. And Randy is going to talk about the recent conference. He's going to talk about M.A.P.S. And perhaps you might find that you are even disabused of any misconceptions that you may have about psychedelics. So with that in mind, Randy, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Mel.
Tell us about your mission at M.A.P.S. What is the mission of M.A.P.S.?
M.A.P.S, while we're registered as a 501c3 nonprofit organization to do research and education, we see ourselves more as a nonprofit pharmaceutical company. And our mission is three parts. We we're investigating whether psychedelic psychotherapy can be an efficient medicine for the treatment of diseases such as, or ailments such as PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, end-of-life anxiety, drug addiction. We hope to eventually make these drugs into legal prescription medicines for use in psychotherapy, and then to open clinics around the country, around the world, where people could go have psychedelic psychotherapy legally. And then lastly, we want to educate the public honestly about the risks and benefits of psychedelics, drugs, and marijuana. Mm-hmm. So what we see now currently is there's a lot of propaganda out there and a lot of misinformation about psychedelics, a lot of disinformation about psychedelics. Disinformation being that's intentionally disseminated in order to confuse people or make them believe things that are not true. And we're trying to cut through the lies and bring out the truth. And sometimes the truth is there are risks, but we also want to share the benefits. Mm-hmm.
There are other psychedelics that you could focus on. Why are you focusing on MDMA?
So we are focusing primarily on MDMA, which is the main ingredient that's in the street drug known as ecstasy. And the reason we've chosen to focus on MDMA is that we are far ahead in the game in the drug development process. I'll try to be real brief about this, but in order to develop a drug into a medicine, it has to go through several stages with the FDA to prove that it's safe and efficacious at treating an ailment. Since we're a nonprofit and we're never going to make money on making MDMA a prescription medicine, we have to count on a plethora of work that's already been done with MDMA, with research with MDMA, and this has been funded by the U.S. government through the National Institute of Drug Abuse, trying to find out what's wrong with MDMA. They have done our phase one studies for us. Mm-hmm. So we are far ahead in the game. We're into phase two studies now, and in 2 to 3 years, we hope to be in phase three studies, and in about 8 years to 10 years, we expect to have MDMA as a prescription medicine.
Right. And I hear there are really quite a few soldiers that have PTSD.
Oh, the toll on our soldiers right now is unbelievable, and the amount of money that we're spending in disability and to not treat them. Mm-hmm. And the treatments out there aren't very good right now. We have two drugs that are legal on the market, that's Paxil and Zoloft, and then we have various forms of talk therapy. But we don't have a good combination of psychotherapy and a medicine yet. And that's what we see promising with the MDMA. Our next study that we're doing here in the United States is exclusively with soldiers who've come home from either Iraq or Afghanistan, or hopefully a few from Vietnam, to see if we can help them out with MDMA-assisted psychotherapy.
Right. And oftentimes they have trouble getting help from the Veterans Administration. There are long, long waits, I understand.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, you have an interesting story. How did you first become interested in the medical applications of psychedelics?
Well, I benefited myself from psychedelic psychotherapy, and when I was in my early 20s, I became addicted to heroin and cocaine. I was an intravenous drug user, and I battled that for about 4 years. I tried traditional treatments with limited success and only short interim periods of abstinence or non-excessive abuse, and I would keep going back to abusing heroin and cocaine. And I learned of a drug called ibogaine on the internet. Ibogaine is a derivative from a natural root from Africa called iboga, where they use it in culture for rites of passage and for healing ceremonies. And I found that they were claiming that this drug had efficacy at treating drug addiction, at getting people off of heroin and other opiates without them going through the harsh withdrawal symptoms. Mm-hmm. Now, this drug wasn't available in the United States, but I found a doctor in Mexico City who was administering it, and I traveled to Mexico City when I was 25 years old. I did the ibogaine once, and I've been clean from heroin and cocaine ever since.
Yeah. Now, that would amaze people how you could take a substance like ibogaine once and then be free of an addiction. How does that work?
Well, ibogaine is a very unique substance, and I don't want to sit here and confuse anybody to think that I believe that it, in and of itself, it's a cure. I think it's a great tool, and it's a great tool for two aspects. One, it metabolizes into a drug that can relieve opiate symptoms without going through the harsh withdrawal symptoms. So people typically, when they get off of opiates, they go cold turkey. You've heard about it. They're puking, they have diarrhea, they're jumping out of their skin, they can't sleep, and they go back to using because it's easier to use than it is to face these symptoms. What ibogaine does is it metabolizes into another drug called noribogaine, which replaces the opiates in the opiate receptors and stays there for 3 weeks, allowing somebody to slowly come off of the opiates without going through those symptoms. Mm-hmm. The other part of this experience is that it tends to cause reactions in somebody's long-term memory. And it's a very intense trip. This is a 24 to 36 hour trip. It's not something that I would advocate as fun. You get a taxi, you lay down on your back, you're not going to be able to move. If you try to move, you'll vomit. But during this experience, you're likely to see things from your past, and you're able to try to come to terms with those experiences. Now, it's not that the day after the ibogaine, I was completely healed. But what it did is allowed me to have all these issues that I was suppressing with heroin. You know, what I was suppressing with drug addiction, way down
psychological
here,
issues.
Psychological issues. I was now able to bring them to the forefront of my head, and over the next several months, with the help of cognitive behavioral therapy and family and friends, and putting myself in a good situation, I was able to deal with those issues and put that behind me. And I so much so that I don't consider myself. You'll hear a lot of drug addicts refer to themselves as in recovery, always in recovery, a lifetime. They've been clean for 25 years, but they're in recovery. I'm recovered. I don't have a worry that I'm going to fall back and go back to using heroin. That was a part of my past that I learned from, but I was able to beat it.
I'm curious, was there a moment, was there a point when you realized that I am no longer addicted? And how did you come to that?
Well, I have two great stories I'd like to share. One that really amazed me, it was about a week after I did the ibogaine. I didn't feel great. I mean, I was weak. I'm 6 feet tall, I was like 145 pounds, I wasn't sleeping very well, and I thought, I'm just going to go use just one more time. I'm just going to use one more time, and I snuck away from my girlfriend, and I walked down the street, and I got on my cell phone, and I called my dealer, and when the dealer picked up the phone, and I expected, you know, meet me on the corner, I got $20. Instead, out of my mouth came, Spanky, I did the ibogaine, and it worked, and I hung up on him. And I never saw it coming. Uh-huh. And then the other thing that just happened was over, you know, just to be honest with you and anybody that's watching the show, I did revisit and use heroin a few more times over the next few years, but I would use it once and I'd put it down, and I'd use it once and I'd put it down, and then I realized, well, I haven't used it again in a year and a half. I guess I don't have the cravings anymore. I don't have the interest. And being able to use it once and put it down was very powerful for me, because instead of having that fear that, oh, once I use it once, I'm going to go right back to using it every day and be permanently addicted, I felt empowered by having done that. And now, as I said, I'm 34 years old and you know, haven't done this in years.
I think there are other substances that have a similar effect. I know that some people might try ayahuasca, and the experience might not be quite so dramatic, but nevertheless they feel they're not addicted anymore. They feel perhaps, one, they're no longer depressed. I understand that one experience on ayahuasca can do that.
So Mel, what you're talking about, ayahuasca is a drug from the Amazon.
Right.
It's a brew that contains DMT.
There are other
DMT.
Substances that have a similar effect
and
on
I
people.
I think that it's a really positive line of research that we should investigate. In fact, M.A.P.S. just started is funding a study in Vancouver where we're looking at ayahuasca for the treatment of addiction.
Really?
And I think it's promising, because ayahuasca is very likely to help people have that spiritual experience. And even if we look at the most dominant recovery path in the world, which is the 12-step program, and you go and look at the big book, and you see what happened to Bill W., the founder of 12 Steps. He says he was laying in the hospital, and he had a God experience, and after that God experience, he realized he didn't want to be an alcoholic anymore. Well, what was his God experience? The doctors had given him a large dose of belladonna, which is a psychoactive root, and or a psychoactive plant, and that's why he had that experience. So ayahuasca, it's even safer than ibogaine. While it might not be able to get somebody off the opiates without them going through the withdrawal symptoms, it shows a lot of promise for addiction, and hopefully it'll be available soon in the future for people.
You coordinated the recent Psychedelic Science in the 21st Century event, which attracted so many people and was so successful. And I'd like the audience to understand more about what that was. And so we have a roll-in, a cutaway shot with the founder of MAPS, Rick...
Rick Doblin, PhD.
Yeah, his beginning address, I've edited it so that the main points are stressed, but could we see that right now so we can get a better idea of what this conference was about?
Right here, right now, in this place, at this time, we've assembled most of the world's experts on psychedelic science, on the science of the mind, on therapy, on psychedelic spirituality, on the mind, the heart, and the spirit. And the eyes of the world are on us. And they're on us because these tools connect us to what most makes us human, to love, to spirituality, to meaning, to forgiveness, to healing. There's an intense interest in what these tools can bring us to into the human spirit. And because there is this interest, there also is this necessity on our part to try to refine what we're doing. As we gather momentum, right now there's more psychedelic research taking place than at any time in the last 40 years. I've been thinking about this conference for many, many years, and we've had several different dates that we would abandon because it didn't feel like we were ready. And finally, we set this date, we've stuck to it, and all of you here have testified it is ready. This was the right time. And in part, it's the right time because we've learned the lessons of the 60s, some of the key parts of what splintered this whole society apart. I think for me, one of the key lessons is that there is no hope in counterculture, that there is no way that we can be safe and free outside of a dominant culture, that we have to have our goal be to move into the heart and be part of the mainstream. And we are. If we look at all of us here, how much we've contributed. The UNESCO Charter says, since wars begin in the minds of men, it is in the minds of men that the defenses of peace must be constructed. I think many of us have this intuition that there is something about this unitive experience that really can build understanding beneath our separateness. And that if we can help people to reach this level, that then there'll be a better opportunity for dialogue and not such a quick reaction to war and violence. But what I'd encourage you to do is to listen to the silences. Listen to what people are trying to say behind the words. What I hear is a message of hope, that these tools can really help us delve into the human spirit, inexhaustible sources of energy, renewable energy, and innovation and intelligence and creativity and art, that there's something that we're all trying to point to. And it's so hard to do so. It's ineffable, and we'll try our best. But do your best, really, to listen to the voice of the heart in the silences. And then we can take that with us as we go home. But now we have this precious opportunity of these 3 days to work together, to think together, to think critically, to build a community and strengthen our connections. And if we do so, and we will do so, we will be able to expand and integrate psychedelic science in the 21st century. Thank you.
Randy, Rick was talking about something that's really rather ineffable. He was talking about, he's referring to the mystical experience that a psychedelic can bring on. And, you know, it occurred to me that, you know, we're here in Silicon Valley, you had the conference here in Silicon Valley, and I'm wondering, is there an affinity between high-tech innovation and the mind expansion that is offered by psychedelics? I remember that Steve Jobs once said that taking LSD was one of the two or three most important experiences in his life, and I can't help but wonder if his mind might have been opened by this experience to possibilities beyond the ordinary that we're all benefiting from right now. Do you have any comment on that?
I suspect you're right. we did choose Silicon Valley for a reason. It is a hotbed of innovation and intelligent people that are trying to be progressive and push things forward. So we chose to have our conference here. Without a doubt, psychedelics do cause people to expand their frame of reference and their thoughts and can increase creativity. And then when you're talking about mystical experiences, what our sister organization, the Hefter Research Institute, has found when they did their research at Johns Hopkins University is that the majority of the time, if we give somebody a psilocybin experience, somebody that has an affinity for wanting to have a mystical experience, they're going to have it. Mm-hmm. So we can help people who are struggling spiritually or searching spiritually, who haven't had a chance to find one of these psychedelics on their own. In the future, when it's legal, they can come and, you know, to one of our clinics or somebody else's clinic and do this legally.
Right. I think since the 60s, there's been this pernicious attitude that psychedelics are hedonistic, they're self-serving, they're escapist, they have no redeeming value. How does MAPS deal with this misconception? I realize that in the 60s there was no real disciplined effort to concentrate on set and setting, which is really what's essential if people want to have a trip that's supported, a trip that can bring out the best for what it does.
Just a few weeks ago, I went down to a festival in Los Angeles where 185,000 people attended over 2 days. And it's a large electronic music festival, and I'm going to wager that 90% of them either did ecstasy or some other psychedelic drug. And while I would also wager that 90% of them had a great time, I think that the situation is set up that it's not the best place for a youth to go and have their first psychedelic experience. So what we've done in a culture of prohibition is we've forced the youth and people, not just the youth, to go and do these things illegally, maybe without a guide. And what we would like to see is that people can do these things in the safety, in a good set and setting, where they are supported, and if they do experience something that's difficult, that there's somebody there that can guide them through it and they can make the best of that difficult experience, as opposed to ending up in a hospital or a jail cell or something.
Right. At the very beginning of this show, you said that, you know, you're here to tell the truth about psychedelics, you know, both good and bad. And yet, the drug war propaganda often causes a boomerang effect. So how do you deal with that?
You know, this is one of the things that I studied at the university in my graduate studies is, you know, how do we communicate honestly or about drugs in a way that's effective? And what we've seen in, you know, coming from the Office of National Drug Control Policy is a very failed method. And when they put out commercials that show a hot, sexy girl smashing eggs with a frying pan, they're just showing that drugs are cool. Uh-huh. And if we want to make people believe that drugs aren't cool, then we have to show a normative effect of the cool people aren't doing drugs. Mm-hmm. Now, that's not the truth, though. The truth is that some cool people are doing drugs and some aren't. So what we need to do is not be so concerned that the youth are going to do the drugs, because they're doing them. I promise you, the kids are doing the drugs. How do we make it safe for them? How do we give them honest information about it? So how can we get them regulated drugs as opposed to adulterated drugs that are coming off the streets? And right now, the system isn't set up that way. I'll say it again, that we are in a harm maximization approach as opposed to a harm minimization or benefit maximization approach. And myself and my colleagues and everybody else I know that's working in the psychedelic movement or even the drug policy reform movement is trying to push us towards a harm minimization and benefit maximization approach.
Mm-hmm. I understand that we've talked about this, but psychedelics can initiate mystical experiences that can profoundly change lives. And yet the mental health industry and medicine in general has pathologized spirituality and mystical experience. How do you deal with this nearly impossible situation that people pathologize something that can change your life dramatically and beautifully, and yet they're prohibited, the people who pass the laws are prohibited from taking it so they can learn otherwise?
Well, you know, it's a slow and steady wins the race sort of strategy that we're in. And what MAPS has done is we're not working in the political arena trying to get people to vote for psychedelics. We never would win. But we're working with the FDA to make these psychedelics into medicines. And the FDA is great. They're here for science. And if we can show them that our science is honest and good and that we can benefit people through psychedelics and we can treat ailments, then they're going to make it a medicine. So this, unfortunately, there's nothing I can do tomorrow to make these things available to everybody that would want them legally. Mm-hmm. They're already available illegally. They'll get them if they want them. But our goal is maybe in the next generation that people can come and find these things, and these scientists who now may be scared because they don't want to lose their tenure or lose their job with whatever it is, won't have to have that fear, and we'll be able to explore these far reaches of their mind.
Right. In Rick's talk, he said, listen to the silences when people speak. Maybe then we can understand each other better. I talked to a filmmaker at the conference, Richard Meach, and he has produced a film. It's called
Vine of the Souls.
Vine of the Souls, right? Encounters with Ayahuasca. And I was impressed with him as a personality, but in the course of my interview with him, he said something about love. And if you listen very carefully to what he says, I think people can get a glimpse, a glimmer of what he's talking about. So it's a short, relatively short clip, but I would like to see that. So if we could see this brief clip from Richard Meach.
One of the most important things about ayahuasca that I have experienced and that I have found in my conversations with other people is that at the most profound level of the healing that ayahuasca gives you, or the spiritual awakening that it provides, is that it takes you into a zone in your own experience, in your own mind, to experience a kind of love that you may never have experienced in your life. So I just wanted to offer that insight that on the deepest spiritual level, that ayahuasca and other substances, other plant, sacred plant substances can provide people is an access to some of the most profound parts of one's sacred experiences, which is ultimately an experience of love. And by that, I mean the love that in some ways you might say is not from here. It's the love that permeates the continuum, and people feel an aspect of that in themselves, and they feel a connection to that that they may never have experienced in other ways. So it's important for people to understand that at the basis of this sacred technology that ayahuasca is a way of reconnecting to yourself, to the planet, to the cosmos, and the energy that underlies all of it.
That's pretty powerful.
Yeah. Well, you know, it makes me think about is that most of the people that I know who have used a psychedelic drug are people who have transcended prejudice. I don't find homophobia. I don't find racism. I don't find people that are ushering to go off to war amongst the people who are choosing to use psychedelics as part of their life. So love is about it. Now, that's not going to be for everybody. You know, some people are going to take a psychedelic and want to go hunting or something, but I think that the majority of people who do these things do transcend this and open up to love more than they would otherwise.
Randy, what do you imagine a post-prohibition society would look like?
In a post-prohibition society, we'll just focus on psychedelics since that's my organization. And we hope, as I said, in the part of our mission will be to have clinics where people could come and say, I want to have a spiritual experience, or I had a trauma, or I want to have couples therapy and be able to have a therapist there to guide them. Or a young person says, I've heard great things about LSD, and I was thinking about going to this party next week, and I want to take some LSD there. And we would say, okay, before you take your LSD, you need to read this book and watch this video, and what is your set and setting when you go there? Are you prepared for this? And here is the LSD that you're going to take, and we know it's unadulterated, and this was what the dose is. And that's what I would like to see in a post-prohibition society. And I also would like to see a society where we're not locking up 2 million people in the United States for nonviolent crimes.
In his talk, in his introductory statement, Rick said that now is the time to start this. Now is the time that we feel comfortable doing this. Would you talk briefly about that?
As he said, there's a struggle that happened. You know, there's a big backlash in the 60s, but we've moved past that. I think a lot of the people that had the fears may have passed on by now, and people that are coming of age into power don't hold those same fears. Now, we're not a full majority that can just vote this thing out, but at least people are more accepting and willing to talk about it, allow the research to proceed, allow the debate to proceed, and not to have the same fears they had about it.
Uh-huh. Randy, guess what? Our time is up.
Can I say one more thing real quick?
Briefly, yes.
Okay, so M.A.P.S. is a nonprofit nonprofit organization, and we're based on membership donations. So if anybody's interested more, please visit us online at www.maps.org and become a member.
Okay. You know, I only covered about a third of the questions I had in mind. Maybe we can do a part two in your offices in Santa Cruz.
Maybe.
Okay. Randy, thank you so much for being on.
Thank you, Mel. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Linda fellow, sit by me, kaya di di da da da. Medicine I don't see, ora yamu yamu me. Linda kasi tay ni ma, ora yamu yamu me. Nai na nai na nai nai. Dai da dai da dai dai di, dai da dai da dai dai di. Linda salo sit by me, dai da dai da dai dai dai. Ora medicine I need, senari di dai dai.